Selamat siang. Hello everyone. Welcome to day one, the third session of today of Mayantara JAC ID 2021. This is a live virtual interior design festival. This is a collaborative event hosted by HDII Jakarta and with Mayantara. Thank you for joining. So my name is Naila. I'm a member of HDII DKI Jakarta. And now involved on programs for year 2019 to 2022. So HDII is Himpunan Desain Interior Indonesia. It's a professional organization, and we are representing interior designer in Indonesia. Also, in the panelists is Rina. Hi, Borina. She's the Ketua of HDII DKI for the same period. So let me introduce everyone. The session of topics for today is the future of work. And today is presented by Rifio. Ibu Fifi Manan is also here. Hi, Ibu Fifi. And also she's the CEO and president of Rifio Indonesia. Bu Rifio, can you kindly please introduce yourself and also Rifio? Thank you.
Thank you, Bu Naila. Good afternoon, everyone. First of all, I would like to thank HDII and Ibu Rina for the opportunity in participating in this wonderful event. Please allow me to share briefly about Rifio Indonesia. Rifio has been the authorized sole dealer partner of Herman Miller for Indonesia for over 6 years. So since we became dealer, we have completed many large projects in almost every sector of industries, such as in banking, technology, insurance, mining, consulting, pharmacy, consumer goods, legal offices, media, transportation, travel, hospitality, and so on. As you might have known, Herman Miller has been around for 116 years, since 1905. And Herman Miller kept acquiring companies that now we have 9 brands under Herman Miller Group, which are Herman Miller itself, Geiger, CBS, DWR, Not One, Hay, Mars, Maharam, and Nemtsov. Many people thought that Herman Miller only manufactures ergonomic chairs, but it's actually beyond performance seating and office furniture. We carry complete range of products from workstations, meeting tables, loose furniture. We also carry iconic design products for home, and the designs are beautiful and functional at the same time. So almost all our products carry a 12-year warranty. In Indonesia, the HM Group iconic design products are displayed in our new showroom in Kemang, named Rifio Design Quarter, to give you an amazing experience for architecture and design community, also for Indonesia iconic design collector and consumers. Besides having a uniquely designed showroom, Rifio also has a solid team that consists of experienced sales team, client solution specialists, ergonomic specialists, customer care, and project management team with skilled in-house installers. We answer to any inquiries within 48 hours, and we maintain close relationship with our clients as our partners to grow together. Thank you once again for joining this session. I hope you would gain the knowledge for the future of work and hopefully win our lucky draw at the end of this session. Thank you.
Okay, thank you, Bu Fifi. So thank you so much. So now let me introduce the two speakers of today's session. We'll have Tatiana from Herman Miller. Hi. So Tatiana is from Herman Miller, Hong Kong. She's a workplace strategist, a creative designer, and a workplace knowledge consultant. She's also a strategic advisor to clients in order to deliver innovative change management strategies and design space. So Tatiana today will present the future of work. The second speaker is Prapancha. Rapaja Muhtar is the principal of QSpace, expert in workplace design. He has 32 years in interior design experience with multinational and local corporate clients, BUMN, government offices, by advising strategic design to his client. And his presentation is about the hybrid office, about the future office. So, hi Pancha, I forgot to say hello to you. After both presentation, we will have a discussion between moderator and the two speakers. It's going to be more detailed about the two topics. And after that, we're going to have a Q&A session. And as Ibu Vivi was saying, we have two prizes for the best question. So please put your question you write on the Q&A below. You can have it in English or in Indonesian, it's okay. And Pak Alex from Herman Miller, hi Alex, he will be the one to pick who are the best question and who is going to win the prize. So now let's start for the first presentation by Tatiana. Please share your screen. Thank you.
Thank you, and good afternoon, everyone. Thanks for making the time today and for actually joining in today. So as part of my introduction, I am a workplace consultant. I am based in Hong Kong. I'm part of the Global Insights and New Business Innovation Group for the AMEA region at Herman Miller. And in my role, I talk with a lot of our customers. And over the past few months, one of the most common topics that came and that clients and people wanted to explore with us has been the future work. So as you know, and as it was mentioned at the beginning of the when we kick off the presentation, Herman Miller is not only a furniture company. We have been researching for the future work for more than 60 years. And as you can imagine, we got quite a bit to share on this topic. So the leveling effect of a global pandemic touches every aspect of life, home, work, and all places that are in between. So once the organizations acknowledge that work can happen anywhere from everywhere, the goal becomes finding ways to best support people at home, at the office, or beyond, with an understanding that workers might seek out for different spots, different settings for different reasons. So today we're just gonna share a little bit of the insights of the future work and what are those three shifts that we have found moving forward post-pandemic. So let's start by why do people will return to the workplace? So we need to understand that people don't want to come back to your office. Your people need to come back to a better office. And as I walk you through this presentation, at Herman Miller, we had identified basically three different shifts. Today's document reflects our findings and point of view on the future work. Our global research and insights team embarked on a 6-month virtual listening tour around the world. And basically what we had was over 160 conversations with leaders from a range of industries, as well as real estate and interior design firms. And almost every organization that we spoke with in this process of re-evaluating what is the future of the workplace and what are the strategies, people are actually wondering what the future holds moving post-pandemic. So from our perspective, this widespread opens to change and it's actually very, very exciting times that we're living at the moment. So we have identified three of the most important shifts that workplaces everywhere must take to remain relevant. When you are ready to explore further, we will be here actually to help you out and help you promote those strategies in the workplace. So let's just acknowledge with the COVID-19 pandemic, there were some accelerated trends that had been slowly germinating for years. So basically moving from working from home or working everywhere, it was a trend that we have seen coming in the past 10 years. However, it was accelerated by COVID-19. Through the early weeks of the pandemic, organizations and employees struggled with the sudden shift to remote work. But a year after the initial lockdowns, business leaders have warmed up to the idea that their people could stay productive away from the office at least for part of the week. Some of the findings said that up to 70% of organizations are planning for at least some portion of the workforce to continue working from home or working remotely. This information is actually coming from a global research survey from Gallup. So one of the first things that we said is we are seeing a shift in the industry from forced acceptance to an actually in a strategic advantage. And one of the things that the other speaker is going to be talking about in his presentation is about a hybrid workplace and what is a hybrid strategy. So one of the things that we're going to touch base on today in Herman Miller's presentation is how a hybrid strategy promotes inclusivity and equity experience in the workplace. So even before the pandemic, and this is something that, again, it was happening and we have seen it in the past 10 years in the industry, offices were struggling consistently to support people and their work. So for many organizations, the physical office didn't keep pace with the technology. It was often generic and too densely planned with deprioritizing remote work. However, when given the choice, many employees had already begun working from home, working from co-working spaces, working from cafes, or working from elsewhere. As we look to the future, we see an opportunity to reorient the office so workers feel less anchored to it and more attracted to it. As facilities focus on hosting experiences that actually bring us out of this isolation that the pandemic actually brought us into. So what are those things that organizations can actually make for the spaces to be more desirable and for the workspace to be more desirable? So one of the three things that we have identified is basically people are gonna come back to the workplace for community and socialization. They're gonna come back for team collaboration. And those ones who cannot actually focus at home, they will come to do and perform individual focus groups. So this data, you might be wondering, where is this data actually coming from? And it's coming from over 19,000 responses that we have on a virtual free tool that we have created at the beginning of the pandemic. And it's called the Work From Home Ergonomic Assessment Tool. And based on the information that we collected over those 90,000 responses, we landed some of these findings. So what are those three things? How do we break down the community and socialization, the team collaboration, and the individual focus work? So the first one, when we talk about community socialization, we talk about helping people feel a sense of purpose and belonging. So how do a company actually achieve having a sense of community and socialization? So what we said is basically help people provide areas that encourage people to interact with their extended networks in the office. And when they are coming back into the workplace, basically reconnect and reestablish those pre-existing conditions. The second one, when we talk about collaboration, in the first model that we have for the workplace, individual and workstations were primarily assigned. What we are saying is basically there will be a shift to unassigned and on-demand spaces, and basically switching from that assigned work desk to actually group spaces that are shared. And then lastly, when we talk about individual focus, what we have seen, and it's something that has been really stretched with the starting of the pandemic, is that in the past year, our homes in many ways just turned into classrooms, gyms, offices, and all the above. So there's people who actually need to come back to the workplace to do focus work. So learning from others and actually getting to reestablish those connections with our workspace is basically why the office matters. So what are those aspects of the work experience that we are not developing and experiencing while working at home? So the first one that we see is learning from others. So knowledge transferring, coaching, and this is something that we have seen has been particularly affecting younger groups or people who just joined companies. The second one, new employee experience. So this relates and ties with the first one. So new hires need to adapt and develop meaningful connections. So how do we actually manage that when you haven't even been to the office when you were hired, or you haven't even met physically or face-to-face your boss or your team? Then when we talk about non-verbal communication, what happens when you have when you are doing communication face-to-face? What are the gestures, the expressions, the tone of voice, eye contact or lack of it, body language, posture? There are different types of communications with our body that actually can reflect trust or distrust. And lastly, when we are actually talking about a space that encourages people to interact with their extended networks. So are we actually considering those spaces where people can come and connect with their departments or even with different departments? So this is one thing that we have identified and why the office, it will stay relevant. So organizations that embrace distributed work in a manner that it actually ties it with the culture and with the company values will ultimately empower their employees with a robust set of choices to create positive health work, positive work experiences. And how can we actually move forward looking into post-pandemic work? So there are a couple of things that could tap into productivity when you have a very high diverse workforce. So what are those three things that you should look into and you should actually start looking before you're forcing people or you're taking any step when you want to bring people back into the workspace? So number one, examine a hybrid approach to workplace strategy. And what this actually means is that you are actually empowering the employees with a different set of choices to create positive different experiences. Second one, when you talk about embracing the unique role of the office, make the office more desirable and more inclusive. And number three, when we talk about empowering people with the tools and reshape the space, it's not only the physical tools, but it's also how you can adapt the spaces. How can you provide furniture that can actually adapt, that can be movable, where people feel that they have a level of control over the space, and individual control and a group control, and also a space that is inviting the people who use it and to reshape it with the needs of the day of the moment. So just to wrap up, this thought, we are actually talking to have a flow plate that actually enhances and creates more flexibility and actually adapts to users. So what are those three approaches and those three big findings when we ask companies and when we check what companies are actually doing moving forward? So what we have identified is that technology has been reshaping the work for decades. But it took this virus to actually change the office landscape overnight. So in the early months of the pandemic, many organizations focused on adapting their spaces to provide safe work environments and limit the spread of COVID-19. However, organizations now are turning their attention to broader perspectives on employee well-being. Our view is that an effective workplace strategy and a strategy must emphasize in different sense and it should have a holistic approach. So in the past, workplaces were considered as flexible, but were not actually giving us the opportunity to be reconfigured by ourselves, by individuals. Now that we are moving forward, we see that change is always expected whenever. And what people are actually looking forward is that when you come into the workplace, you should be able to reconfigure and move things just to actually suit the needs of the moment of the day. So let's take a look at the new three approaches that we have discovered. So number one is, we call it binary. And binary is basically where the headquarters, we want to call it now the headquarters, the workplace, the space is being reimagined. So what is happening is that employees are viewed as either office workers or remote workers. It's either one or the other. And people are expected to work in their designated location. So either at home or even remotely. One thing that we have seen with this binary approach is that the offices are actually being reimagined and people are actually providing lots of types of settings designed for collaboration. The second one, where you talk about hybrid workplace, and basically what we have identified is that 50% of the companies are moving forward with hybrid workplace. The headquarters is moving to everywhere. So employees are empowered to split their time between working from home, and working at the office, or working elsewhere. And the organization mindset that are taking the hybrid approach are actually considered to redesign their offices and support work at home to address employees' needs. And lastly, we have only 5% with remote first. And what is saying with remote first is basically the headquarters are becoming an event and a collaboration center. So what happens here is that working from home becomes the primary location, and then it provides employees with a smaller regional satellite or in-demand office. And what happened with this approach is basically people are and companies are bringing their employees based on community events. So now that we have an overview of some of our findings, we would like just to guide you through some of the placemaking and some of the layouts and some of the furniture that we are expecting to thrive moving forward post COVID-19. So what are the new expectations, or what are those new expectations that people have for their work experience? So one thing that we have identified is that now in the workplace, it was something that it was not that obvious before, but there are three major zones that are coming as emerging zones. So you have the connection and socialization, you have immersive collaboration, and then you have one part of the office where it's focus and concentrate. If you look at the bottom of the screen on the right-hand side, you will see that there is an emphasis on community and in groups type of work, and also in groups, how do you move into individual focus work. So just to give you an overview of some of the settings and things that we have seen moving forward, we are just here reflecting 10 typical settings that we currently have, and how are those related to community and group and individual type of work. So when we were able to identify not only the settings, we were able to identify the way how people actually work. And this is coming from a research piece that is called the team landscape. And basically in that piece of research, we identify that there are at least four different distinctive types of teams in the workplace. So what we are doing at Herman Miller, we're using music as a metaphor to describe the work of each team. And we classify it as following. So the first one, you have a team of soloists. So each individual performs the same type of work independently, following the same process, but learning from each other. And the studio musicians, basically their members conduct their work independently, but with an aligned vision of how the work will come together and be compiled into the final piece. When we talk about orchestra, it's basically a large and diversely skilled team under the same direction with the same leader. So it's a little bit of a more complex system of work when you have an orchestra team. And lastly, and finally, when you talk about the jazz ensemble, the team creative's work is immediate and in a spontaneous response to the work and actions of other team members. So just to give you a little bit of an example of how we are planning on how are we facilitating conversations with workplace, with real estate, and with our customers in general. What we have understood is that, yes, you have three main emerging zones, but also those emerging zones are are linked with four different types of activities that happen. So the first one, you focus and concentrate, you have space for connection and socialization. You have once another room or another settings where you talk about immersive collaboration. And lastly, when you're actually hosting. So these are just some of the examples, and we're just gonna show you different neighborhoods within that flow plate.
Tatiana, you only have like about less than 5 minutes left.
Yes. Thank you. So these are just some of the ideas that we have placed together for how you can actually have those different types of settings. And when we talk about furniture and what are those trends and what do we see and what are we expecting to see moving forward, what we have understood is when people are coming back to the workplace, the teams are looking for the agility for actually create work as individuals of working in teams. So we're just gonna go through a couple of reference of new pieces of furniture that will be actually be available very, very soon in the region. These are from Herman Miller. And majority of this family of furniture is actually mobile. So it's all on casters. Even the working stations are on casters. So what I'm going to show you is basically how you can rearrange using exactly the same settings, how you can have different ambience within the same floor plate and within the same neighborhood. Also, one thing that we have identified is that people want to have ownership over the way how they work and the way how they configure the space. So these are some ideas for you guys to consider moving forward. So you can turn easily a meeting space into a touchdown or a welcoming space. And just to wrap it up, not the least important, also allocate space for individuals. And what does it mean when people want to return to the workplace to do individual work? So these are some of the images that we have for today. And remember that it's not only about supporting what is happening in the workplace, but it's also supporting what happens at home and what happens elsewhere. So just to wrap it up and just to leave it with you guys and pass it on over to the next speaker, what we say is that when you are talking about shaping the future of the office or shaping the future of working, there are a couple of key elements that you should take into consideration. So the workplace should look into, and when you're looking into a strategy, you should question and ask yourself, why, when do we come back? Where where do we work? Do we work from home? Do we work at home? Do we work elsewhere, from anywhere? What does it mean? And how do we work? And what is the main element that actually ties all this together, which is flexibility? What does it mean to be flexible in the workplace? I'm just gonna leave you with those thoughts, and I hope you enjoy today's presentation. Thank you.
Thank you, Tatiana. Thank you for your presentation. And it seems that we're all going to a new concept now. So we're forgetting the old way. We're talking about the hybrid, the full remote, and also in between. But are we going to go back later on when the COVID-19? But let's discuss this later on during our discussion.
Okay.
Yeah, that's one point that I want to discuss with you. So now is Pancha, and Pancha will present about hybrid office. Pancha, kalau misalnya mau dimulai, silahkan.
Yeah, okay.
Share screen ya. Thank you.
Oke. Okay. Selamat siang semuanya. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Terima kasih untuk HDI, JAK.ID, dan review yang sudah mengundang saya untuk menjadi salah satu narasumber di webinar ini. Oke, ini waktunya nggak terlalu banyak, dikasih hanya 20 menit, jadi harus agak buru-buru, agak cepat bicaranya. Jadi, kita mulai ya. Jadi, sebenarnya latar belakangnya itu adalah sebenarnya karena pandemi. Ya. Jadi, karena ada pandemi ini, banyak pertanyaan. Sebenarnya banyak pertanyaan mengenai next work itu seperti apa, next office itu seperti apa. Gitu. Sama seperti dulu atau akan berubah, itu pertanyaan-pertanyaan seperti itu sudah mulai terdengar. Nah, tapi sebenarnya kalau kita lihat tarik ke belakang, ya, pertanyaan-pertanyaan itu juga udah lama sering ada. Sebelum pandemi pun pertanyaan-pertanyaan itu selalu ada. Next office itu seperti apa? Tahun depan seperti apa? 2 tahun lagi seperti apa? Apakah masih sama seperti sekarang atau ada perubahan? Perubahannya seperti apa dan sebagainya? Itu selalu ada. Jadi next-nya itu office itu seperti apa? Sebenarnya base-nya itu bukan next office itu seperti apa, tapi next work-nya seperti apa? Orang cara bekerjanya seperti apa? Itu yang akan mengubah desain dari sebuah office, akan mengubah strategi dari sebuah office. Jadi bukan desainnya, tapi cara bekerjanya. Dan pertanyaan-pertanyaan itu banyak sekali, sampai ada juga yang bertanya bahwa office itu masih ada masa depannya apa enggak? Gitu. Apakah masih ada future-nya, mengingat kita teknologi kita sudah sangat, yang ada sekarang sudah cukup canggih, sudah sangat canggih, sehingga semua bisa bekerja secara remote, sehingga ada pertanyaan bahwa apa kita masih perlu office gitu. Mungkin jawabnya nanti setelah ini ya, setelah ini, mungkin di belakang kita bisa ketemu jawabannya seperti apa. Cuman kalau kita coba tarik ke belakang lagi, sebenarnya apa sih yang membuat perubahan-perubahan itu? Apa yang membuat perubahan? Kenapa ada perubahan di cara kerja atau desain itu berubah? Tolak ukurnya apa gitu? Supaya kita bisa kira-kira memprediksi, oh akan berubah ke arah mana. Yang paling gampang adalah sebenarnya kita lihat dari teknologinya aja. Perkembangan teknologinya seperti apa, progres dari teknologi itu seperti apa, bergeraknya ke arah mana. Teknologi ini yang kemudian nanti akan mendrive orang bekerja itu seperti apa, dan akhirnya desain office itu menjadi seperti apa. Itu karena teknologinya. Itu yang paling gampang, itu tolak ukur yang paling gampang, kita lihat ke situ. Dan itu sudah terbukti dari mulai saya bekerja 30 tahun lalu sebagai workplace designer, ya begitu. Teknologi itu sangat berpengaruh terhadap perubahan-perubahan dalam desain. Kemudian juga isu-isu yang ada di global issue, apa misalnya dulu ada isu mengenai green design, itu juga merubah sudut pandang orang terhadap satu desain yang tadinya tidak terlalu concern terhadap lingkungan, tapi sekarang tiba-tiba menjadi sangat concern terhadap lingkungan, dan impact-nya cukup besar terhadap dunia desain sampai sekarang masih terasa. Kemudian juga untuk desain office itu yang pengaruhnya cukup besar adalah ketika generasi milenial mulai masuk ke dunia kerja, dan mereka sudah mulai menduduki posisi di mana mereka bisa mulai mempengaruhi suatu keputusan. Gitu. Ini berubah, sangat berubah gitu dari office yang sebelumnya sangat, apa namanya, mungkin kita kenal sangat hierarki itu, office sangat hierarki, menjadi office sangat bebas, sangat istilahnya agile gitu, sekarang agile. Karena memang behavior dari milenial ini dan culture dari mereka ini yang sangat beda dari kita. Mereka yang sangat dynamic, kemudian dalam organisasi juga mereka sangat flat, kemudian lebih terbuka terhadap perubahan-perubahan, lebih mudah beradaptasi, dan mereka adalah generasi yang sebenarnya sangat dekat dengan teknologi. Kalau generasi sebelumnya agak kurang, tapi generasi milenial dan sesudahnya itu sangat sangat dekat sekali dengan teknologi. Nah ini kira-kira hal-hal yang menyebabkan berubah gitu, berubah secara total. Berubah itu bukan artinya berubah secara stylenya lah atau warnanya atau apa, bukan, tapi secara strategi desain itu berubah gitu ya. Nah sekarang tiba-tiba ada pandemi kan, ada pandemi, dan pandemi ini memang luar biasa sekali. Kita sudah tahu semua impact-nya seperti apa, besar sekali ke seluruh dunia, cepat sekali, dan tidak ada yang menduga secepat itu, dan tidak ada juga negara yang siap menghadapi ini sebenarnya, karena ini datangnya begitu tiba-tiba. Nah, sudah tentu pandemi ini akan sangat berubah cara orang atau behavior orang dalam berinteraksi, sangat-sangat berubah itu. Dan artinya cara berinteraksi pun akan jadi perubahan, dan office itu pada akhirnya juga pasti akan berubah. Cara bekerja office akan berubah. Cara orang memandang office itu akan berbeda. Standar-standarnya akan berbeda. Jadi kira-kira apa yang paling berubah gitu ya, berubah. Misalnya dalam segi kepadatan kantor. Kepadatan kantor ini menjadi akan berbeda gitu. Dari tadinya yang padat gitu, yang mempunyai rasio tertentu, menjadi satu rasio yang jauh lebih besar. Jadi pandemi ini dampaknya akan kuat sekali, bahkan lebih kuat daripada zaman milenial kemarin ini waktu dia datang. Karena ini langsung berhubungan dengan masalah kesehatan kita dan akhirnya pada nyawa kita gitu, sehingga orang tidak kompromi lagi dengan masalah ini gitu. Harus seperti yang sebaik-baiknya. Jadi gini. Seorang itu untuk dapat bekerja dengan produktivitas yang baik, dia harus mencapai suatu level kenyamanan tertentu gitu. Kenyamanan itu artinya apa? Kenyamanan itu artinya misalnya mengenai masalah keselamatan, keamanan, dan kesehatannya. Itu yang paling basic ya. Itu sebelumnya kan ada satu level tertentu lah, ada satu standar tertentu dari orang yang segini gitu. Cukup segini. Nah, dengan kejadian pandemi ini, itu akan menjadi standar, itu akan menjadi lebih tinggi lagi. Orang akan menjadi lebih sensitif, orang akan menjadi lebih demanding terhadap lingkungannya. Sehingga mau nggak mau lingkungan itu harus berubah. Tempat dia bekerja itu atau tempat lainnya pun harus berubah menyesuaikan dengan kondisi saat ini. Gitu, karena kejadiannya sangat sangat banyak menakutkan bagi banyak orang, dan bisa juga membuat trauma tertentu ya. Jadi dalam 2 atau 3 tahun ke depan tuh paling enggak banyak terjadi perubahan seharusnya. Karena itu sudah menyangkut masalah keselamatan dirinya. Apabila dia masuk ke suatu lingkungan yang tidak nyaman, dia merasa tidak aman, mungkin dia akan resign aja dari kantor itu. Semudah itu mereka akan melakukan itu, karena itu sudah benar-benar masalah keselamatan jiwanya. Oke, jadi kalau kita lihat gambar ini, di Jakarta itu yang kira-kira yang biasanya itu rasio dari sebuah kantor, jadi rasio itu semacam kepadatan dari sebuah kantor gitu ya. Itu rasionya antara 1:8 sampai 1:10 rasionya ya. Itu yang paling umum, bisa sedikit lebih kecil, bisa sedikit lebih besar. Nah, tapi untuk sekarang masa pandemi ini atau post pandemi lah kita bilang itu, sepertinya rasio seperti itu nggak bisa diterima lagi gitu. Orang akan merasa risih gitu dengan kepadatan seperti itu. Dia ingin sesuatu yang lebih besar gitu, sesuatu yang ingin lebih lega, mungkin sampai 2 kali lipatnya gitu. Jadi yang tadinya rasionya 1:10 berubah menjadi 1:20 gitu. Nah, itu yang diinginkan oleh si employee-nya ya, oleh orang seperti itu. Tapi kan dari segi perusahaan untuk membesarkan perusahaan menjadi 2 kali lipat lebih besar sepertinya nggak mungkin. Karena itu akan menjadi terlalu mahal, terlalu costly gitu. So, jadi apa yang harus dilakukan? Apa yang harus dilakukan? Nah, sebenarnya jawaban dari itu adalah gini. Jawaban dari itu tuh muncul dengan sendirinya gitu sekarang ini. Tanpa suatu research, tanpa suatu perencanaan yang khusus seperti itu, terjadi dengan sendirinya. Yaitu bekerja secara remote gitu. Sekarang kita mengistilahkan itu dengan hybrid work gitu. Hybrid work itu artinya kita bisa bekerja di kantor kita atau kita bisa memilih kerja secara remote, jadi bisa di rumah misalnya. Nah, ini tapi cara kerja ini sebenarnya bukan suatu yang dirancang, direncanakan gitu, enggak. Ini terjadi dengan sendirinya gitu, dengan seperti ini gitu. Dan setelah disurvei tadi dari Herman Miller kan ada hasil surveinya ya, kurang lebih 50% atau lebih dari 50% orang ketika ditanya memilih mana nantinya, tetap bekerja di rumah atau dia ingin kembali ke office, surprise-nya tuh sebagian besar tuh tetap menginginkan bekerja di rumah gitu. Which is itu jadi sesuatu yang baru gitu, sesuatu yang baru untuk kita. Tadinya perubahan itu susah sekali. Ketika office konvensional berubah menjadi agile misalnya, itu susah sekali merubah behavior seseorang, culture seseorang dirubah itu susah. Tapi kejadian ini ternyata bisa merubah orang dengan gampangnya dan ternyata mereka oke dengan sistem yang baru itu. Jadi hybrid work ini atau hybrid workplace ini adalah sesuatu yang sangat sangat fleksibel gitu. Cara kerja yang sangat fleksibel, sangat mobile, baik untuk dirinya ataupun juga untuk si perusahaannya. Jadi kalau kita lihat dari gambar ini, dari slide ini, kira-kira begini. Jadi kira-kira ada HQ-nya ya, ada office-nya tengah, kemudian ada di kiri kanannya ada remote area-nya, bisa di rumah, bisa di tempat lain, atau bisa juga di satellite office. Ini bagus juga ide kalau ada bisa ada satellite office-nya. Jadi mereka bisa memilih tempatnya, dia mau bekerja di mana, di kantornya atau di rumah. Atau bisa juga si kantornya yang schedule gitu. Si kantornya bisa schedule berapa hari kamu di rumah, berapa hari kamu di kantor. Dan sekarang kalau kita lihat pembagiannya seperti itu, apa yang kita lakukan di kantor kita, apa yang kita lakukan secara remotely, apa yang bisa kita lakukan di situ? Apa bedanya kedua tempat itu gitu? Yang prinsip itu apa bedanya? Di head office atau di kantor itu, atau begini, face-to-face meeting itu penting ya. Jadi secara quality, face-to-face itu akan jauh lebih baik daripada meeting secara Zoom seperti ini. Dia akan lebih fokus, kemudian dia untuk mencapai suatu, atau ketika kita sedang membicarakan hal-hal yang sangat strategik gitu, untuk menyamakan visi, menyamakan misi, menyamakan sinergi, itu direkomendasikan untuk meeting face-to-face. Jadi headquarter atau office itu lebih ditekankan nantinya hanya sebagai hub, hanya sebagai tempat bertemu, tempat face-to-face, dan yang dibicarakan di situ juga untuk meeting-meeting yang sifatnya high level, yang strategik, atau kita sedang bekerja dengan sangat kreatif, kita sedang brainstorming, mencari ide-ide baru, atau kebetulan mungkin ada problem besar gitu. Nah, itu dikerjakan secara di office dengan face-to-face. Sementara yang di remote, itu pekerjaannya mungkin lebih kepada yang sifatnya technical. Dan komunikasi yang dijalankan secara digital, secara Zoom, mungkin juga komunikasi yang lebih technical, lebih ringan lah, seperti itu. Jadi hybrid ini ada beberapa keuntungannya ya, advantage-nya, ada beberapa value-nya. Tapi yang paling utama menurut saya, hybrid ini fleksibel. Jadi fleksibel bagi si orangnya, bagi si pekerjanya, employee-nya, tapi fleksibel juga bagi si perusahaannya. Jadi perusahaannya bisa meng-adjust, gitu. Dia bisa mengatur kantornya kapan di banyak orang, kapan dia agak sepi. Gitu. Tergantung dari kondisi yang ada saat itu. Misalnya lagi pandemi, wah kondisinya lagi benar-benar lagi zona hitam, zona merah. Itu dia bisa atur sedemikian rupa sehingga yang di kantornya sedikit aja, nggak terlalu banyak, atau mungkin nol sekali. atau nggak hanya masalah pandemi, atau misalnya di kotanya, misalnya kita di Jakarta lah, misalnya lagi banyak banjir lah, atau lagi banyak demo-demo lah misalnya gitu ya, atau ada situasi yang kurang aman misalnya, dia juga bisa mengatur siapa yang datang ke kantor, siapa yang nggak perlu, siapa aja yang perlukan dari kantor, kalau nggak semua bisa bekerja secara remote dari rumah. Itu salah satu value dari si hybrid itu. Selain daripada lebih efisien dari segi real estate cost, itu pasti ya. Karena dengan cara ini, setiap perusahaan bisa kembali mengecilkan atau membuat kantornya menjadi lebih kompak gitu. Perkiraan saya sih, ini perkiraannya, perkiraan paling enggak bisa menghasilkan sekitar 20% ya. 20% itu bisa dibikin lebih kecil. Kemudian yang nomor 4 itu ya udah pasti, jadi menghindari atau mengurangi penularan virus dan sebagainya. Kemudian freedom to more deep work. Jadi seorang tuh bisa lebih free untuk memilih tempat kerja yang paling nyaman untuk dia. Kita tahu orang itu macam-macam karakternya. Ada karakter orang yang dia lebih bisa fokus di tempat yang tenang, yang lebih private, nggak diganggu suara-suara. Biasanya itu orang yang introvert istilahnya. Atau juga ada yang ekstrovert yang dia bisa lebih nyaman atau dia bisa kerja, dia bisa fokus di tempat yang open bersama teman-temannya, dengan timnya, sambil diskusi, sambil apa, dia bisa tetap kerja dengan fokus, bahkan lebih fokus di tempat seperti itu. Jadi dengan sistem hybrid ini, setiap orang akan menjadi lebih fleksibel lagi untuk memilih tempatnya. Kalau dia perlu fokus banget, mungkin dia nggak kantor, dia di rumah aja. Bisa seperti itu. Kemudian nomor 2 itu hybrid locally dan globally. Sebenarnya ini udah terjadi juga, tapi mungkin akan bisa menjadi lebih banyak lagi. Jadi setiap perusahaan itu bisa meng-hire profesionalnya atau staffnya di mana aja. Perusahaan yang di Jakarta dia bisa meng-hire staffnya dari Jogja lah, atau dari Denpasar lah, atau kalau perlu hire expat dari luar negeri, dari London, atau dari New York, dari mana, tanpa mereka harus memindahkan orang-orang itu ke Jakarta, apalagi expat pindah ke Jakarta. Siapin apartemen, siapin mobil, siapin sopir, terus harus ada izinnya, kitas dan sebagainya. Banyak urusannya. Dengan sistem remote kan dia bisa langsung bekerja, tetap bekerja di kotanya. Itu salah satunya. Dan banyak lagi keuntungan-keuntungan yang bisa diperoleh dari si hybrid ini. So, jadi kalau kita bicara future workplace, kuncinya apa sih? Key point apa? Key point sebenarnya adalah flexibility, itu aja. Makin ke depan, ini kemungkinannya ini pasti. Ini hanya perkiraan berdasarkan pengalaman ya. Jadi kemungkinan ke depannya makin fleksibel, orang kerja makin fleksibel, makin tidak ada border gitu. Dunia pun makin nggak ada bordernya kan, makin komunikasi segala macam bisa lebih makin lama makin mudah segala macam. Begitu kira-kira office-nya seperti itu. Nah, kemudian ini saya coba bikin case study supaya ada ilustrasi sedikit supaya lebih jelas. Oke, ini ada satu plan dari satu project. Tapi ini contoh ya, ini asumsi. Jadi ini adalah plan, original plan, jadi pre-COVID lah, pre-pandemi ya. Jadi total areanya, net areanya itu 2.000 square meter. Dari 2.000 square meter, kapasitas yang bisa dicapai sesuai dengan standar-standar safety dan sebagainya dari DKI lah, dari standar-standar safety, lebar koridornya lah sebagainya, itu sebanyak 239 work point. Jadi bisa ada 239 orang di dalam lantai ini. Jadi kalau kita lihat rasionya itu sekitar 1:8. Itu bisa diterima pada saat pre-COVID ya, pre-pandemi. Tapi kalau sekarang, saya sepribadi agak ragu ya. Orang masih mau nggak dengan kepadatan seperti ini gitu? Risih apa enggak? Masih nyaman apa enggak? Masih tetap bisa produktif apa enggak? Yang jelas level of kenyamanan kerja itu nggak segini lagi, pasti menurun nih ya. Seperti ini menjadi menurun. Tadinya udah oke, semua udah memenuhi standar, tapi sekarang menjadi turun, menjadi tidak nyaman kerja seperti itu. Jadi apa yang bisa kita lakukan? Paling nggak kita bisa memodify kantor apa yang udah ada. Apabila memang kita sudah punya kantor existing yang baru lah misalnya gitu ya. Yang jelas apa yang harus dilakukan? Pertama, rasionya harus berubah. Dari tadinya 1:8 misalnya menjadi lebih besar. Jadi 1:20 misalnya. Misal ya. Kenapa segitu? Saya juga belum ada research yang mengatakan harus begitu, tapi yang jelas harus lebih lega, harus lebih sepi gitu kantornya. Terus itu di sini hanya ada 100 work point aja, 100 work point. Dan workstation-nya pun harus diganti. Jadi yang tadinya biasanya kita duduknya hadap-hadapan kan, sebelumnya kan hadap-hadapan dengan desking system, bench system itu duduknya berhadap-hadapan, paling dipisahkan oleh partisi yang nggak terlalu tinggi di depan kita. Tapi cara itu sekarang kelihatannya orang akan risih, nggak mau lagi seperti itu, maunya berubah. Gitu. Workstation harus diubah, jadi tidak bisa lagi berhadap-hadapan, tapi harus dibikin seperti yang beberapa ini, kita lihat di layout ini, selang-seling gitu, jadi tidak berhadap-hadapan. Gitu. Satu itu, kedua, karena kantor nantinya hanya sebuah hub, jadi itu sebuah hub sebenarnya. Selain tempat kerja, tapi lebih berfungsi sebagai hub, tempat pertemuan. Jadi sepertinya breakout area harus lebih banyak, gitu. Meeting room lebih banyak. Breakout area yang tadinya apa di open area, open space gitu, katanya akan lebih baik kalau breakout area itu dipindahkan ke enclosed space. Kenapa gitu? Karena di dalamnya pasti akan ada komunikasi-komunikasi yang sifatnya digital tadi, dengan Zoom, supaya tidak mengganggu orang dan supaya tidak terganggu juga komunikasinya. Jadi breakout area harus diperbanyak. Dan juga kemungkinan ya, team room atau project room juga harus diadakan. Jadi bedanya project room dan collaboration area itu, kalau collaboration itu mungkin orang hanya pakai sejam dua jam gitu. Kalau itu area itu harus ditinggalkan. Tapi kalau project room, area itu bisa di booking sehari, dua hari, atau mungkin lebih lama dari itu. Jadi itu benar-benar ada tempat berkumpulnya satu tim ketika dia sedang mengerjakan suatu project tertentu gitu. Atau untuk mencapai satu target tertentu gitu. Jadi dia perlu taruh file di situ, taruh mungkin ada tambahan komputer di situ dan sebagainya. Jadi approach-nya beda.
Maaf Pak Panca, tinggal 5 ya. Menit. Okay, kurang siap. Dari 6 menit.
Oke. Okay,
terima kasih.
Oke. Okay. Dan pengalaman juga yang perlu diperhatikan sekali adalah quiet room. Dari pengalaman proyek terakhir kami cukup besar di Jakarta, setelah selesai ternyata quiet room-nya kurang. Padahal sudah cukup banyak quiet room yang kami bikin, ternyata kurang. Kenapa gitu? Karena sekarang komunikasi lewat Zoom semua, Zoom. Jadi quiet room harus banyak, jumlahnya harus banyak. Yang bisa dikurangi adalah ruang meeting untuk tamu. Biasanya kita ada satu floor untuk tamu kan. Nah, itu ruang-ruang meeting itu bisa dikurangi jumlahnya karena tamu tidak lagi banyak datang ke kantor kita atau datang ke kantor klien kita lah misalnya gitu. Dan perusahaan juga biasanya tidak mau lagi terima terlalu banyak tamu. Dia menghindari itu. Sehingga space-nya bisa ditukar antara meeting room dengan si quiet room itu. Oke, selanjutnya ini hanya contoh-contoh aja. Collaboration area bisa macam-macam lah. Nanti di center bisa datang dengan macam-macam ide. Collaboration area-nya yang jelas itu harus dibikin untuk kebutuhan macam-macam atau bentuk-bentuk kolaborasi itu seperti apa. Ada terbuka, ada juga yang tertutup seperti ini, yang project room tadi saya bilang. Approach collaboration area room-nya itu beda. Jadi dia ada apa namanya? Ada filing room-nya, ada tempat untuk misalnya ada mock-up lah, ada model, ada segala macam. Dan ini yang penting, jangan lupa bahwa quiet room harus banyak, jumlahnya harus cukup banyak, karena ini pasti yang diminati banyak orang. Oke, terakhir, sebelum yang akhir, walaupun kita dunia ini bisa semua serba remote, serba digital, kita tetap harus perlu tahu bedanya virtual, untuk secara virtual meeting, dan face-to-face. Ya. Jadi secara quality, face-to-face akan jauh lebih baik, tetap lebih baik. Jadi, itu kenapa office itu tetap perlu. Nggak bisa nggak ada office. Semua virtual itu nggak bisa. Tetap perlu ada hub, ada tempat di mana tempat kita bertemu langsung. Face-to-face meeting itu jauh lebih berkualitas, jauh lebih punya makna untuk menjalin hubungan supaya lebih baik, relasi lebih baik, dan sebagainya. Dia lebih fokus, kemudian untuk menyamakan sinergi, menyamakan visi itu di sangat direkomendasikan, disarankan untuk face to face. Sementara meeting yang sifatnya virtual memang itu praktis, cepat, lebih murah, lebih aman, dan sebagainya. Tapi itu hanya sebatas meeting-meeting yang sifatnya teknis seperti itu bisa dilakukan setiap hari seperti itu. Jadi perlu diperhatikan, jangan sampai kita terjebak kepada dunia digital, jadi kita jadi seolah termakan oleh si dunia digital itu. Tetap kita harus melihat sisi humanity kita ya. Oke, jadi kesimpulannya dari tiga option, bekerja seperti dulu lagi di kantor atau hybrid di dua tempat, kantor dan remote, atau tetap remote, ini pilihan, tapi untuk saat ini, mungkin untuk saat ini yang paling bisa diterima adalah hybrid ini, hybrid office. Jadi dia bisa bekerja di mana aja, itu yang paling fleksibel, semua kebutuhan masih bisa difasilitasi dengan baik. Begitu yang bisa saya sampaikan. Terima kasih, mudah-mudahan cukup jelas. Waktunya memang sangat singkat sekali. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Saya kembalikan ke Naila. Thank you.
Thanks, Manca. Terima kasih atas presentasinya. Kalau kita lihat sekarang memang kita harus bekerjanya sistem baru ya, karena pandemi ini. Yes. Tapi kita diberikan kebebasan. So we given like a free will of all the staff that we can work at home, remote, by the office. But who can do that? Is it all offices or only private offices or multinational offices? Can you see that for the BUMN government?
Okay.
Let's talk about this in our next session. Okay. Thank you, everyone. I saw a lot of questions, but this is something of the question that we want also to talk inside the discussion. So, Tatiana, Ancha, maybe we can discuss now, the three of us.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Okay. So, as we said before, we're talking about hybrid. We're talking about remote, the new work, the new way of work. So, some question was that we said it's conventional office, where 100% of the staff is at the office, and then there's the pandemic. So now we've worked all from home, and then it depends on the situation, 25%, 50%. But also we learned prior to the pandemic that some of the multinational company works activity-based working, which is bekerja sesuai fungsi. We call it ABW. And this is some of the private companies, like multinational companies, like GE or maybe Coca-Cola or IBM. So they work based on the activity. So they can work in a desk or in a project mm-hmm. room. So it depends on where they work. So now is work from home. And now we say hybrid. And also there is also a new thing now in Jakarta, in Indonesia, is WFB. Which is work from Bali. So the government was saying, let's work to Bali. Let's all fly to Bali and work from Bali.
Itu terlalu dari pemerintah itu.
Yeah, that's from the government. I want to do that. That's right. But what is the difference really between previously that we work based on function and now we're saying that we work hybrid? What is the difference? Can you, mungkin Papa, Ancha or Tatiana can answer this? Yes, Ancha first.
Okay. Thank you. Apa bedanya agile atau ABW dan hybrid sekarang ini? Dengan pertanyaan kurang lebih seperti itu ya.
Iya.
Sebenarnya idenya sama. Idenya sama, yaitu flexibility. Jadi seorang sangat fleksibel, dia bisa memilih tempat kerjanya seperti apa, sesuai dengan kebutuhannya seperti apa. Idenya seperti itu kan. Mm-hmm. Tapi agile atau ABW hanya bisa dilakukan on-site. Hanya bisa dilakukan di lingkungan kerjanya dia aja, di kantornya dia. Gitu. Tapi okay. Kalau di hybrid lebih luas lagi gitu, dia bisa bekerja di kantornya dia dengan pilihan tempat kerjanya. Jadi dia punya agile workplace di kantornya, atau dia bisa pilih di luar kantornya remotely gitu. Jadi okay. Bedanya hanya di situ aja sih sebenarnya, tapi idenya sama. Idenya so adalah fleksibel.
Yeah. So what is Apache is saying, Tatiana, that between ABW and hybrid now? It's just about flexible, being flexible, but mm-hmm. now it's the location. You can be anywhere. Before it was like your function is in the office, but now it's you can work from anywhere. Is it another point that you want to add on to that?
Yeah, so what we have found out through, there are two things here. One thing is what the data is saying, and another thing is what we have actually identified that is not even related through to industries. So it's not whether or not you're a government institution or you're a tech company or you're a financial institution. We have actually a mixed bag of experiences, even within financial institutions and even through tech companies. So the approach that Google had actually taken a year ago when the pandemic hit it is very different to what they're doing at the moment. So now they want to bring back, for instance, everybody back to their biggest headquarters in North America. And that was not the decision that they had at the beginning. So it's only based on company culture and the actual nature of your work. So that's the first thing. It's not per industries. When we look at the global data, and this actually comes from Leesman, if anyone is interested to actually going and snooping around and know a little bit more about data and analytics and statistics, Leesman just launched the most amazing comprehensive data. And it's actually what we have identified, what we have seen internally as well, is that it's not industry related. That's the first thing. The other thing that we have identified is that there is a sweet spot for working at the office and working at home. So what we have identified is that, yes, it's about flexibility. It's about entrusting your employees that they're going to work and they're going to be productive when they're working remotely. But it also is also related to levels of productivity and levels of engagement. So people are, and we have identified that people who have the possibility to be in a more flexible workplace or in a more flexible arrangement with the company are more engaged. So if you are actually looking into return of investment of your real estate, you're actually saving a big chunk on retraining people. So you have a really higher talent retention when you are allowing people to work remotely. Other thing that we have identified is not like 100% in the office, 100% from home. What we have seen is that there are sweet spots for both locations. However, global statistics says that at least 77 employees, global employees, total global workforce, want to work from home at least once a week. That number goes higher in Australia, North America, and Europe. That goes slightly lower in Asia Pacific. And that has to do with cultural nuances. So some of the other things that we have seen is that even if you have a global strategy, you actually need to revise how are you implementing that and what are those cultural nuances that are happening in Jakarta, because it's not the same working in Jakarta than working in Mumbai or working in Manila. So those are some of the things that we have identified, and we actually tell companies and be very, very careful of cultural nuances. However, other piece of data that it came out through that research, it says that at least 16% of total global workforce don't want to come back to the office space. Mm. So people just 16%, and this is not a small number, they're saying they do not want to come back. And then there's only 6% who has identified that they don't want to work from home at all.
Okay.
So if you see the numbers are quite staggering.
High. So everyone wants to be home, not to work at the office if you from your numbers. Okay, so now Pancha. This is really, but we've been doing it for 1.5 years. Udah 1.5 tahun kita kerja dari rumah. Mau apakah itu perusahaan swasta atau perusahaan siapapun juga kan, kalau terjadi ini, apakah ini bisa juga di ini untuk konsep bekerja seperti itu BUMN dan perkantoran pemerintah?
Oke, saya nyambung tadi yang disampaikan Tatiana itu ya. Jadi sebenarnya yang menentukan adalah culture mereka mau seperti apa. Pemerintah bisa juga tergantung dari ya, di departemen apalah misalnya begitu ya. Mereka bisa juga bekerja seperti itu gitu. Kenapa enggak? Kalau BUMN pasti bisa karena dia sebenarnya sifat kerjanya kan sama. dengan kantor swasta yang lainnya. Mm-hmm. Ada satu proyek BUMN yang sedang kami kerjakan, mereka juga sekarang ini menerapkan cara bekerja seperti itu. Cara bekerja, memang mereka tidak mengenal kata-kata hybrid office itu, mereka kenal. Tapi apa yang mereka lakukan sebenarnya hybrid, gitu. Bahkan hampir semua kantor sekarang, ya kan? Jadi mereka bekerja seperti itu, gitu, nggak di kantor. Jadi mereka memang kerjanya di rumah. Kantor-kantor kita juga kan rata-rata semua di rumah, gitu. Mm-hmm. Memang dari pengalaman yang di pemerintah paling susah untuk diubah, gitu. Karena memang culture-nya agak sulit, dan juga satu hal begini. Misalnya perusahaan-perusahaan finance gitu ya, from finance itu, mereka itu tergantung juga dari kantor regulasinya, regulatornya, tergantung dari BI misalnya. Kantor mereka sangat masih meminta hard copy yang banyak, hard copy. Jadi belum dengan soft copy, dia hard copy. Sehingga dia akan susah kalau dia harus kerja remote gitu. Dia harus kerja di kantor karena wah semua hard copy ada di situ gitu. Semua tanda tangan belum bisa digital, masih harus tanda tangannya asli gitu ya. Jadi sebenarnya semua bisa berubah, tapi tinggal sistem apa? Sistem mereka yang harus berubah dulu gitu. Tapi
and us as a designer, we have to help them. Harus advise client.
Ya kita bisa meng-advise, tapi kita nggak bisa merubah sistem dia. Meng-advise bisa, tapi kita nggak bisa bilang ke BI misalnya, wah kamu jangan pakai hard copy lagi dong, ya nggak bisa. Gitu.
That's right. That's right. So the last question about this new work, do you think that is going to be only during the pandemic and then when it's normal we go back to the conventional, or how do you see this? Is it going to be something lasting or just temporary? Tatiana, your turn.
Yeah. So what we've seen and what we deeply believe is that this is here to stay. It was a trend that had started about 10 years ago, but we really look and track back these people in North America who has been working for at least 30 years remotely. So this is not something new. Just the scale of this, of course, is new, and the way that we've been basically forced to work at home, it was new. However, we have identified that, and companies have identified that they can actually reduce some of the real estate portfolios when they are having a hybrid or unflexible strategy. So from what we've seen in the statistics and what we heard from our customers and what we've seen with A&D firms is that it is here to stay. Of course, it's also depending on the generation. So what we've seen is that the older generation are more willing to work remotely. Younger generation want to return to the workplace just for the sense of community and actually bringing, helping to build those networks. Also, how do we train and how do we get people on board? It's a whole new aspect of this pandemic. However, I guess with the technology and the advances that we have at the moment, I mean, the fact that I'm here sitting in Hong Kong, Alex says in Singapore, you guys are in Indonesia, it actually says a lot of how are we going to move forward. And it's actually decentralizing technologies, helping us decentralize the way how we communicate. So I think it's here to stay. It's just going to vary depending on the region and also depending on the nature of work. If you're working in a call center and you need, or if you're working in tech processes or even in a lab, we were actually working with the lab facilities in North America, and they all wanted to actually remain at work at home, but they had to come back to the workplace just because the nature of the work. So it's also based on what you do. What is your role?
Okay, that's Tatiana. What about you, Anca? Gimana?
Okay, gini, secara teori gitu, secara teori memang ke depan kita bisa hybrid. Tapi juga saya pernah ikuti seminar yang lain. Cara seperti itu, yang paling challenging itu di bagian HR. HR. Itu nggak gampang. Jadi berubah menjadi sistem seperti itu, buat mereka, waduh itu perlu satu sistem baru. Bagaimana mengontrol karyawannya kalau dia bekerja remote di mana-mana? How to control them? Gitu. Nah, itu harus ketemu dulu tuh sistem itu. Gitu. Kalau nggak, ya nggak bisa, apalagi perusahaan-perusahaan besar ya, nggak bisa, susah sekali. Nah, sekarang itu bisa berlaku gitu karena kita kan terus terangnya kita terpaksa begitu, ya kan? Karena kondisi yang begini ya kita terpaksa menjadi hybrid. Tapi nanti kalau situasinya udah benar-benar aman, apakah tetap bisa begitu? Nah itu sekarang PR-nya ada di IT dan HR menurut saya. Okay. Mereka pegang kendali ya. Kalau bisa, bisa bagus. Nah apakah kita akan kembali ke mana? Ya, konvensional tadi ya?
Semuanya dedicated. Everyone is at the office 100%.
Ini pengalaman saya. Masih tetap ada tuh.
Masih ada kan?
Masih ada. Jadi agile itu ide yang bagus lah. Sangat fleksibel ya. Itu ide yang seru gitu. Tapi yang seperti itu tetap ada. Tetap ya. Ada. Nggak bisa dihilangin itu. Tetap ada. Bahkan perusahaan-perusahaan swasta yang kelihatannya wah kamu harusnya modern banget ya. Tapi ternyata kantor kamu kok nggak gitu. Tapi itu tetap ada gitu. So, karena jumlahnya makin lama makin berkurang.
Ya. Yeah. Tatiana is the same. Papancha is saying it's about function. It's not all that can do the same system. So it's all about who they are, how they function. Maybe in one office, it's only one part of the office, one department who can do this dedicated system, or the marketing, or you know, the sales can do the agile thing, the hybrid. So it's all about function. It's all about the company, and it's all about the HR. HR human the rules of the office. Yeah, so okay, yeah. So our 15 minutes is up, but I think that this discussion can go further. But again, I think this is why we like to be interior designer, ya Pancaya. So yeah. We should be creative. We should be innovative. But it's always to learn something new, so it's not boring. So you know, you don't do the conventional. Yes. You don't do the activity-based working. Now it's the pandemic. Let's do something new again. You know. So, but again, it's also about to learn about scope related to our interior design. So it's like new technology that we should know now. That's the new materials, but also the new way of life, of work. And this all will affect our design. So thank you. Now we go to the Q&A. So some of the question. I saw one that is from, from Pak Johannes Octavianus Siagian. He was saying, does the company do need also to check how the workers work at home? Or do we as interior designer also say, oh, you work from home and this is how you work? But I haven't done that because our project is only for the office. But do you think as a change management consultant, do you think that we also need to have a standardization about how they work at home?
So one of the things that we have seen is not a standardization, but actually providing people with the tools. And when I say tools, it's not only about furnishing. So what we have seen, a lot of tech companies and even Herman Miller has given to employees a fee allowance to actually furnish their home office. So what we see in Google and Facebook at the beginning of the pandemic, they allowed $1,000 to actually buy whatever they needed to be comfortable at home. That's the first approach, just thinking about furnishing. The second approach from the HR and the change management side is that companies have to actually train and let their people know and learn how they can set up the work from home setting. So when I talk about setup, it's talking about the lighting. Do people have actually access to natural lighting? Do they have a dedicated room? Do they have a dedicated surface? And these are things that we actually been working with customers for almost a year since the pandemic started to create programs for them to deploy with their employees. So it's not only about the furniture, but also what is happening for those people who are working remotely. What we've seen with financial institutions is that normally before the pandemic, they were not used to work on laptops. They were only used to work on desktops. And that was one of the big things and the big realizations from a lot of banking is that their employees could work on laptops. So they were furnished with laptops, they were given laptops. Another example that we have, this is Herman Miller one, we were given the possibility to purchase furniture just to help us just go through the pandemic. Some others, and there's some legislation that we have seen in different parts of the world that hasn't really landed here in Asia Pacific for one reason or another, but that has landed in North America and in Latin America. We have seen at least six countries that have government have actually launched new regulations and legislations for when people work remotely. So there's also a liability. Why is an issue liability? Because if you don't inform your people how to work the best when they're working from home, you're gonna create ergonomic problems. You're gonna create well-being and health issues that will have to be covered later on by your insurance. So it's hand on hand.
Okay. Kalau Papanca, what do you think? Should we also sebagai interior designer harus ngikut-ngikut ngedesain atau membuat aturan bagaimana bekerja di rumah?
Mungkin itu enggak. Tadi yang saya bilang itu PR-nya HR tuh. Jadi kita tidak perlu membuat terus di rumah kerjanya harus bagaimana gitu. Itu bagian yang lain harus memikirkan itu. Tapi memang harus dipikirkan ya. Jadi bekerja di rumah pun harus mempunyai satu level kenyamanan yang cukup baik gitu. Itu harus dipikirkan oleh perusahaan. Jadi bukan berarti si perusahaan itu terserah kamu remote mau kerja di mana aja terserah kamu gitu. Ya mungkin apa itu atau gimana? Harusnya sih dia memikirkan juga ya. Ada concern juga ke arah sana.
I'm only concerned about Tatiana when she said that companies are giving like computers and so on to the staff. I don't think that we'll do it here. Maybe some companies, but not all.
Yes.
But again, we know that there is technology, right? We know when they work, when they are connected to the system and so on. Mm-hmm. I think the technology also is one thing that will help the transition between the office work and at home. It's not about how to be comfortable, but also to be, so that's the connection to the office through technology. Mm-hmm. Okay, maybe there is another question, maybe from Alex or from Wufifi that you see that we can...
I think, Naila, there's a very interesting question here from, I think, Veruska Juanita. I think she asked basically what a company should do to embrace hybrid work style if now their office is in more of a traditional setup then.
Okay.
Yeah.
So maybe Panca, boleh duluan?
Okay. Ini Faik, ini kayaknya saya kenal. Jadi gini, sebenarnya masa sekarang ini adalah masa untuk ngecek kantor masing-masing ya. Bisa nggak kita bekerja remote di seperti ini gitu? Sekarang saatnya. Tadi yang pertanyaan kan bagaimana kalau apa? Tadi saya baca lagi ya. Kalau office sangat tradisional gitu, bisa nggak berubah? Nah sekarang masa ngeceknya itu masa sekarang ini karena sekarang kan semua orang bekerja di rumah remote. Nah bisa nggak mereka berubah? Cek aja. Dan dari apa yang saya dengar, saya belum pernah mendengar, saya tidak mendengar ada satu perusahaan atau ada satu departemen atau apa bangkrut atau apa karena pegawainya WFH semua gitu. Kayaknya enggak gitu. Mereka tetap bisa beroperate dengan baik tuh gitu. Memang dari pengalaman kita gitu, merubah kebiasaan orang itu kan susah sekali kan. Dari tadinya tradisional menjadi agile itu wah susahnya sangat mati. Mengconvince mereka untuk berubah itu susah lah. Nela juga pasti punya pengalaman sama. Tapi sekarang kita bisa terbukti gitu. Setelah kalian kerja di rumah bisa tuh gitu kan. Dan malah ada yang bilang lebih enak ternyata gitu. Jadi ternyata kerja melepaskan diri dari kebiasaan yang biasa itu ternyata bisa gitu. Okay, no problem, nggak ada isu gitu. Malah ada yang nggak mau lagi balik ke kantor maunya di rumah aja ada yang seperti itu gitu. Jadi sekarang sebenarnya saat yang baik untuk ngetes kantor kita, orang-orang kita. Budaya kita mau dirubah apa enggak sekarang?
Okay, Aja. Thank you. What about you, Tatiana?
Yeah, so I'm not sure if I can share my screen.
I can see you, but you want to share something?
So I would like to share, and this is very relevant to this question. And just mm-hmm. letting know if you guys can see the screen. And one thing that we have identified for employees and for companies, and this is just to address to this question, how people can actually move into from a very traditional, from a different work style into more hybrid. And what we said is that first thing, not one size fits all. So just be very, very careful with the strategies that you are implementing. Not because you're hearing about hybrid workplace, it means that we're all gonna jump on that boat of work from home or work remotely or hybrid workplace. So the first thing that we say, how do you start this? And we actually created at Herman Miller this 5-step roadmap. And it's basically helping companies create their own strategies through their own data. So the first thing is go through data collection and analytics. So ask your employees what is happening, because you don't know what you don't know. So you need to ask actually, what is their experience? Is it good? Is it bad? What do they miss about the office space? And what is actually working really well? The second one, we talk about vision alignment. So just get those values, company values, and what is the vision moving forward? Do you want to bring people back into the office space? What is the reason to doing that? And do all managers, CEOs, CEO, COO, do everyone is on board with that strategy? So this is when we talk about vision alignment. It's basically from leadership and management, what do they want? Then once you have data collection, you have a vision, you can actually look at the recommended strategies. And then after you have a recommended strategy, you can go into implementation and iteration in your workplace or in your workplace way of working, either you work in the office space or you work remotely. And lastly, always measure the success and always do adjustments. So one thing that is being recommended when you do changes in the workplace, do assess and do surveys and actually check, do a pulse check after 6 months, the change, after you have implemented this 6 months later on. And one thing, just to wrap up our thoughts and what we have identified, Herman Miller, the way how we're helping people is just revisit, reassess and revise. Because as I was mentioning before, with Google, first they say they don't want anyone back in the workplace, and now they're saying they want everyone by September and October. So probably there was something down the line that they identify, they revise, and now they're changing. So those would be some of our recommendations from Herman Miller.
Okay, thank you, Tatiana. So now we have like those two questions. We only have like 4 minutes left. Alex, is it those two that we're going to select? I'm so sorry.
Yeah, I think the two questions that basically would win the CBS Flow arm that is sponsored by Rayfield would be, the first one is Johanna Siagian. Siagian, sorry about that. And the second one will be Veruska Junita.
Okay.
Wow.
Wow. So you and Veruska, congratulations.
Congratulations.
Can you please, on the chat, put your name and your numbers and your contact and your email so that Rifio can come back to you about when you can get the new arm monitor from Herman Miller. Congratulations again. So now we are going to close the session. We would like to say thank you to Ibu Fifi for Rifio to present this session. Also, we would like to say thank you for the speakers, Tatiana Herman Miller and Pancha from QSpace. And also to thank you for joining and do this preparation with Mayantara for Mayantara Jack ID. So we also hope that this webinar will allow us as interior designer to create something, not only what was done before or is now, but to think about also the future. So this is why we call it the future of work. Again, make sure to stay tuned subscribe to Mayantara YouTube channel. So everyone who is late today, they can see through the YouTube channel. And also to go to the locket, please, and see our other session. We still have 2 days of those sessions. And please, our IG, Instagram account is hdiijakarta, refuel.id or mayantara.id. Okay, thank you again, everyone. But again, hold on. The next session at 5 will be Narrating Beauty. It's presented by HDIIDKI Jakarta and co-presented with Written ID. The speakers will be Alex Bayu Saputro with Rifki Goro Effendi, with Rina Penville will be there also, and Arya Serada Hadiyi. Again, thank you all and enjoy our next video. Bye. But please, see the video first before you go. Thank you, everyone.
Bye. Thank you.
Thank you, everybody. Bye.
Thank you.
Thank you. Bye-bye, Ibu Nala. Thank you so much. Thank you. Tatiana, Papanca, thank you so much.
Vivi, thank you. Bye.
Thank you. Bye-bye.
Oh, okay.